What does a profitability case look like and how can you pass it? You'll find out in this video. When you're working on a case, the first thing to figure out is whether it's about solving a profit and loss issue. This type of case comes up the most because as management consultants, our main goal is to help businesses grow. And how do we measure that growth? By looking at profits and revenue. Now, if the interview question addresses a business's profit and losses, P&L, you can apply the profitability formula to solve the problem. If the question only addresses one component of the profitability, either costs or revenues, then you can use the relevant segment of the formula to address it. Okay, as I mentioned, this is the profitability formula. Profits equal revenue minus cost. Profits equal revenue, which is the price times units sold, minus cost, fixed and variable. At the highest level, it's pretty simple, right? At this high level, though, the equation doesn't provide a tremendous amount of insight, but both costs and revenues can be broken down further. Let's do that now. Revenue depends on how much a company sells its products and services for and at what price. Costs are broken down into fixed costs and variable costs. Quantity sold is the number of goods or services sold over a period. Think of it as pounds of bananas sold, hours of personal fitness coaching given, or the number of cell phone screen repairs done. Price is the money charged for the product or service. Fixed costs are the expenses that don't change with the amount of goods sold or change very slowly. These include property costs like rent for offices, factories, warehouses, or retail space, depreciation of equipment needed for production or service delivery, salaries for employees and management, and property taxes. Variable costs, on the other hand, depend directly on the quantity of goods or services sold. For instance, if you sell more smartphones, you'll need to purchase more components like screens and batteries. Variable costs encompass materials used in production, wages for hourly employees directly involved in manufacturing or providing the service, shipping expenses, and credit card processing fees. When you're using the profitability equation to tackle a case interview question, begin by focusing on either costs or revenue. Dig into how each component is changing and ask questions until you pinpoint what's causing the profitability issue. Once you've identified the problem affecting profitability, it's time to brainstorm solutions to fix it. Now you know the basics. Let's move on to how you could use this profitability framework to drive deeper analysis. Let me tell you a couple of ways on how you can dive deeper into a profitability case. First is by breaking down profitability by business segments, or what you call segmenting. When tackling case questions, you might need to compare the profitability of different parts of a company, such as business segments, geographic units, distribution channels, or customer types. Let's consider a clothing brand that is thriving in its online sales but struggling with its brick and mortar stores. To understand the underlying issues, you should analyze the profitability of each segment separately. Online sales profits equals online sales revenues minus online sales costs. Retail store profits equals retail store revenues minus retail store costs. By examining the revenues and costs for each division, you might find that the cost structure that makes the company successful online, like lower overhead costs and efficient digital marketing, doesn't translate well to physical stores, which may be suffering from high rent and operational expenses. Additionally, you might uncover that the product assortment or in-store experience isn't appealing enough to draw customers into the brick and mortar locations. Okay, now let's see how to break down profitability by geography. Imagine the same clothing store sells its products all over the world. To figure out if the core of their profitability issues lies in differences across geographic markets, you can compare the profitability of their different regions and see what's driving any variations. For example, North American clothing profits equals North American clothing revenue minus North American clothing costs. Latin American clothing profits equal Latin American clothing revenues minus Latin American clothing costs. European clothing profits equals European clothing revenues minus European clothing costs. Asian clothing profits equals Asian clothing revenues minus Asian clothing costs. African clothing profits equals African clothing revenues minus African clothing costs. By digging into the revenues and costs for each region, you might discover that the cost structures are fundamentally different. This could be due to factors like government regulations, labor rates, pricing, or competition levels. Analyzing each segment of the business separately helps identify why one part of the company is profitable while others are not. You can also look at profitability by sales channels or customer type, not just by business unit or geography. The best approach depends on the specific case. You might need to break down profitability in a few different ways to find the most relevant insights to solve the case. Apart from segmenting, another way is to do benchmarking. Benchmarking is comparing the client's businesses or a segment to key competitors or the client's own performance in prior periods. So for competitive benchmarking, for example, a competitor might take steps to boost demand for their products and services by cutting costs, lowering prices, increasing advertising spending, expanding their sales team, or opening new store locations. These moves can impact your business's profitability even if you haven't changed anything yourself. As for the client's own performance in prior periods, it's important to analyze the client's cost and revenue structure over time. If costs aren't carefully managed, they'll tend to rise over time. You might hire new employees, expand head office facilities, or face increasing component costs due to inflation. When revenue stays flat but costs keep going up, the profits will get squeezed, even if revenue is growing. If costs are rising faster, you still have a profitability issue. If a company finds its profits shrinking because of constantly rising costs, it can tackle the problem by managing costs better, raising prices, gaining market share, or a combination of all these strategies. Okay, but Bruce, how do I know which profitability analysis is right to use? Well, sometimes the case question itself will give you a clue about what kind of profitability benchmarking you should do. For instance, if the question says a European clothing company is experiencing low profitability in its sales in Asia, start by comparing the cost structure of the European business unit to that of the Asian business unit. If you find differences that explain the problem and help you find a solution, then that's the right comparison. If you don't find any difference in the cost or revenue structure between the two regions, look at the profitability of the Asian business unit compared to its competitors in Asia or its own past performance. Keep trying different benchmarks until you find what explains the profitability problem. If the question is about improving the profitability of a specific product, compare that product's cost and revenue structure to the profitability of other major products the company offers. Let's go over a case to apply this profitability framework to analyze it. This is the case. Our client, Frozen Haven, makes small batch ice cream. They serve the ice cream in the company's restaurant, as well as selling pints and quarts to go. Frozen Haven has been experiencing a decline in profits and wants to turn this trend around. What should they do? Let's go over the analysis. Start by exploring either costs or revenues. Listen to the questions that I will raise in order to do the analysis. Question: how have revenues been trending over time? Well, revenues are down by 5% versus the prior year. Question: I'd like to understand what's going on with revenue by looking at the price and the quantity of ice cream sold. First, has the price of Frozen Haven's ice cream changed? There has been no significant change in either the pricing of either the packaged ice cream or the ice cream served in the restaurant. Question: so the problem has been with the quantity of the ice cream sold? Yes, the quantity of ice cream sold is down 5%. The decline has been about the same across both the packaged and restaurant served products. Question: I'm interested in understanding possible causes for the decline in ice cream sales. Are there any new competitors in the market? No. Question: have existing competitors changed anything about their business? Price, advertising, opening new restaurants? Both our clients and the competitors have added new stores over the last 12 months at about the same rate. Pricing and advertising haven't changed. Question: has our client's product changed? The client has hired a new head of operations 15 months ago. She has over 10 years of experience with one of the biggest mass marketing ice cream manufacturers in North America. She was given latitude to make changes and improve the company's efficiency and profitability. In fact, she's reduced costs by 3%. Unfortunately, that's not enough to offset the reduction in revenue. Question: I'd like to understand the change in costs. Was the cost reduction in fixed costs, variable costs, or both? Variable costs. Question: was the reduction in labor, the cost of ingredients, or something else? The cost of ingredients. Question: what ingredient costs went down? Dollars spent on milk have been in line with the reduction quantity of ice cream sold, as were the costs of flavorings like chocolate, vanilla, etc. The biggest change has been in the cost of mix-ins to the ice cream. The client creates specialty flavors by adding in things like chocolate chips, caramel, and crushed Oreos, and Heath bars, etc. These costs are down 30%. Question: Has the reduction in mixed ins made a difference to the client's customers? That's a good question. We haven't studied this, but a quick review of the client's reviews on Yelp show that there are comments from customers suggesting that they've noticed the reduction in mixed ins and don't like the change. Okay, how was that? Having all that information, I will give this recommendation. Frozen Haven has seen a decrease in profitability resulting from a reduction in the quantity of ice cream it sells both in packages and served to customers in its restaurants. Frozen Haven's variable costs have gone down. That would seem to be a good thing for profitability at first glance, but the cost reduction resulted from smaller quantities of mix-in being used in the ice cream. From a quick scan of Yelp, it sounds like the customers don't like the changes to Frozen Haven's ice cream. I'd recommend using customer focus groups to gain a deeper understanding of what Frozen Haven's customers want in their ice cream. If it turns out that the mix-ins are important to their customers' buying decision, they should return to the former mix-in levels, even if it means spending more money. It will be worth it in terms of increasing sales. It's possible the client's head of operations won't like this recommendation because she made the change to the amount of mix-ins used, probably because she thought that it would increase profitability. But the results of focus groups will persuade her that this recommendation will improve profitability. There you have it, everything you need to know about how to pass a profitability case interview. I'm curious, will you be going through a case interview soon? If you comment below the name of the firm that you'll be interviewing for, I'll share resources on how you can pass the interview. So for example, if you put BCG, I'll send you some resources for passing your interview with BCG. And if you are 100% serious about becoming a consultant at BCG or another amazing firm, I would love to help you. My team and I are former consulting recruiters and interviewers who help applicants get and pass the interviews so they can land their consulting offer. To date, we have a 90% success rate. That means 9 out of 10 applicants who work with us land at least one offer, and we've helped over 800 people already land a consulting job. If you are serious about becoming a management consultant and want to hear how we can help you, click on the link below to book a call with my team to find out more. Booking this call could put you one step closer to landing your offer at McKinsey, Bain, BCG, or other management consulting firms. But you don't have to take my word for it. Hear it from Connor. Connor received an offer from BCG after being rejected by BCG during his undergrad, and despite coming from a non-business background. I'll link to his videos somewhere around me. Okay, that's it for now. I'll see you in the next video.